Hi, I'm Abhinay Jain and you're listening to The Garage Story. In this podcast, we speak to startup founders about their 0-1 journeys, those first often messy step of turning an idea into reality. Powered by CleverTap for Startups, we are all about raw, unfiltered stories of grit, growth and everything in between. Today, I'm very excited to have Ace with me. Ace is building a very interesting startup, which is at the cross-section of gaming and hip-hop. So both, I'm pretty sure, is of interest for a lot of listeners. Ace, how are you? How's your morning going?
I'm good. My oldest daughter just got over her sickness, and now my youngest daughter has the sickness that my oldest daughter had. So juggling that with the entrepreneurial life is always fun, but doing great. No complaints. God is good.
Great. So it's good to start. It's always a hustle as an entrepreneur. For me, the first question that comes is you have been with some of the best names in the market, right? You have been with Facebook, you have been with YouTube, you have had a great career. You yourself are quite versatile, right? In music, with hip hop, so many things. And you are a dad, right? So tell me one thing, how did you convince yourself to leave those comfortable jobs, those, you know, things and with family and everything? How did you convince yourself, hey, this is what I want to do, and for that I'm ready to, you know, go all in?
Yeah, no, Abhinay, that's actually a pretty fascinating question. And I haven't quite thought of it that way. It's kind of like asking a fish, like, how did you know that you were in water and you were going to decide to jump out, you know? But I guess if I had to break it down, you know, while it's dope and I'm really grateful and appreciative of those experiences working at those companies and specifically the people that I worked with at those companies and those name brands, right? I simultaneously never defined my self-worth to those brand names. And so while I was there, it wasn't like, ooh, I'm a Facebook employee. It was like, I'm Ace and I work at Facebook and I'm also a hip hop artist and I'm also a husband, and right, like there's just other, it was just a part of me. And so with Five Mics, this hip hop trading card game that my team and I are building, this is a culmination of everything that I've loved and grown up on since a child, right? Hip hop, games, specifically card games, anime and comics and all these kind of things. And so actually while I was at Facebook, this idea was super small at the time, but it came to mind. It was like, hey, what if instead of dragons and magicians, you had rappers with superpowers? And that was the basis and the premise of the card game. And I just kind of thought it was like, I don't know, like a small little joke, but the thought would not leave me alone. And I just continued to, in the free time that I did not have, but in retrospect, I clearly had, because now I'm a father of two and I feel like I don't have any time now, right? So like I clearly had time. So outside of, you know, working the corporate job, outside of doing shows and making albums and all these things, I was just slowly piecing together this idea of game mechanics and things like that. Not pressuring myself to immediately forsake everything, right? And just do this thing. Cause I didn't even know if I was serious at the time. I was already doing all these other things. And frankly, you know, those were paying bills. So I was very much just doing this because it was a intellectual exercise, if you will. I'm a nerd. I always grew up making my own books that have never been released. I'm an artist, like an actual illustrator. So I've designed tons of characters and tons of ideas. This for me was just another version of that, but just as a game. But then the pandemic happened and I wasn't going outside. I wasn't distracted by the ways of the world or anything like that. And so it was very much just like, okay, I'm doing this job and I'm doing music, but even doing music didn't feel as fulfilling as it used to be when I could like do shows in person and stuff like that. And so this idea like resurfaced and it became that outlet for me to be creative and expressive and really, you know, do those things. Fast forward, I spoke to someone who was like, yo, you should do this immediately. like I would play it. I'm sure plenty of other people would play it. And as I started telling more people about it, that's really when the traction started as far as interest and engagement and people, you know, asking me like real product questions, like when is it going to release, like are you having prototype tested, right? Like those kind of questions. I was like, oh snap, like this is no longer, right, just this little thought child of Ace in some dark corner, like now this is something that I can potentially provide. And being someone that's used to, you know, creating art and providing it as a service, as a product, it just felt like that, right? I didn't really overthink it. I was just like, okay, like, let's see what happens, right? And it was fun for me. I typically thrive in spaces, I feel like we all do, where if I'm enjoying it, then I like it and I want to do more of it. And that's just, it just naturally grew that way. And one thing led to another, and I ended up in Techstars doing 5 mics full time.
Oh, very nice. Very nice. So that gives a good idea about, you loved games, you loved hip hop, you thought, let's bring it together, and did not overthink it and went into it. Was it all alone, or you by then, right, as you mentioned, oh, did you have a co-founder? Did you think about, you know, maybe partnering with somebody, or you went all in by yourself?
Yeah, so the actual game design, it was all me. I did not have a reason or even a desire to like work on it with someone else, because I didn't know if it in itself was going to be a thing, you know? So it was very much just like, even my wife at the time, she was like, what are you doing? And I was like, I don't know. Like, it's this, it felt like a vice, you know? It was like, why am I doing this? But I keep doing it, you know? So it was just me like creating these ideas, but I would literally just print out pieces of paper, write rules, test it out like hundreds and hundreds and thousands of times. By the time I, you know, it was 2022, the top of 2022, when I spoke to this friend of mine who was just like, you need to do this ASAP. Actually, shout out to Daryl Freda, because he's the one that who was just like, yo, you got to do this. That's when I was like, okay, let me find out how am I going to do this, right? And at the time, it was, you know, the pandemic, 2022. So it was like, okay, people, I know they want to go outside, but people aren't really going outside. And so even though I built 5 mics with physical in mind, I was like, okay, well, it'll probably have to exist, or it'll probably serve better as a digital client as opposed to a physical product. And then I don't have to worry about like supply chain and operations and wholesale, retail, and all that stuff. So then I was like, cool, I'll go digital, but I don't know how to code. So I did two things. One, I bought a coding book because I was like, let me teach myself how to code, because Abhinay, I'm that type of person where it's like, if I want to do it, I'm going to do it. I don't, right? It's just, if this is what I need to do in order to get it done, then I'm going to do the thing and I'm going to get it done. But I also spoke to somebody who was like, hey, you don't have to do it all. You can find other people that have these skills, and that way you can move faster. And so I had this book, but I read like 2 pages of it, and I was like, okay, I could learn C# right now, or I could find some other people that like already know C#. And then also like, I'd mentioned that I'm an illustrator, but I don't have to do all the artwork myself. I don't have to do all these things myself, which, as an independent hip hop artist, I'm very used to just doing everything by myself. The artwork, the recording, not the mixing and mastering, but outside of that, right? Like not even the production. It was like outside of those things, I'm doing the marketing, the ops, the sync licensing, all those different things. So this was like the first time where I was like, okay, let me try not doing everything myself. So I went on Upwork. I found some contractors to like do all the other things. And then I just really focused on one, delivering the information of like, this is how the game should play, but then also like crafting the pitch and the story and like actually turning it into a business. Like, you know, how do I convince investors that this is actually a real thing and not just, it's no longer just like Ace's small like thought child. This yeah. actually has potential. And part of that came from, you know, talking to real people, you know, going to conferences and seeing people's reactions and recording that and building a wait list and all those fun things. So,
got it. So that makes sense. So you started alone, but I hear you, and there's actually a good insight here, which you mentioned, which I have seen. In fact, I've spoken to a lot of founders today and yesterday, right? One thing that is common is when they wanted to do something, they had a passion for it, whatever they were looking at. Yeah. Second thing was, they were not stuck whether I knew coding or not, learning. Somehow they started learning and saying, I need to get this thing done, right? That was the yeah. part.
Third thing, which is I'll tell you right now, Abhinay, like now I know how to code. Now it was very much just like, as the CEO of this company, you know, and we are mobile first. We're going to have a physical version, but we are mobile first. And so it's just imperative that I know what's happening, right? Like to work with CleverTap and do the integration with the SDK, it was like, I have to understand the C# script in order to do this, right? Like there's no way I can like be the contact and the person that has no idea what's happening. So anyway, sorry, continue. But Yeah. Fast forward, I know how to code, the very thing that I thought I wasn't going to have to know, just because it's a way of, you have to do it.
Yes, that's one of the insight I saw, that they were ready to learn. If something they don't know, they are ready to learn. That is one very second insightful thing that I got. And third is, whether outsource or have it in-house, right? That's a decision that people do and make and somehow get going. That's the main part, right? You have to get going, moving ahead, right? So that's good to hear from you as well. Now, actually, I'm just still thinking, right? Why do you call it Five Mics? Is there a reason for the name? And a little bit more on what Five Mics is.
Yeah. So Five Mics, the original inspiration of the... So two things. One, when you're playing the game itself, you can only have five artists on stage at a time. So like you can imagine like five microphones, five artists, right, on your side of the stage versus like, you know, you would have up to five artists on your side of the stage. So it's a way to kind of remind you that while you have a roster of artists in your deck that you can pull out and play on stage, you can only have at max five, right? So that's like a mechanical decision. But also just, it's a nod to hip hop culture and hip hop lore itself. Back in the day, you know, if you had an album that, had five mics, you know, it's kind of like a 5-star rating, you know, it was like, oh, you were untouchable. You were like the greatest rapper of all time kind of thing, you know? So it's kind of a nod to that of just like, you know, five mics, like you are playing to be the greatest, of all time, you know? So, it's a play on that, but also it's a mechanical decision as well, just to ensure that you're not like flooding the board with as many artists as possible and all that kind of stuff. But as far as how the game plays, so you know, you and I, we would have 30 cards in our deck. 15 of them would be artists. The other 15 would be a collection of events and items. So there's three card types in our game. There's artists, events, and items. Artists are your creatures, if you will. Those are the ones that do the fighting for you. They have an attack value, defense value. You have items that equip to the artist and like enhance their abilities, so to speak. So like a chain might give, you know, an artist, you know, extra strength or something like that. And then you have events that you can play backstage that can change the overarching context of the game. So you might have a trap card, which is an event where, you know, it might say that the next time that your opponent plays a card, you know, you just destroy that card immediately. You don't ever have to see it, right? So it's like stuff like that. So it kind of puts you on your toes, where it's like there's the things that you see and then there's the things that you don't see. And then, yeah, the artists battle each other, right? And then you have a health value. I have a health value of 30. And so when you get down to zero and you pass zero, you lose, and vice versa. If you get me my health down to zero and then pass that, you win. And it's very fast paced. I mean, you have 12 rounds max back and forth to determine who the winner is. But on average, games will last between like 4 and 7 rounds. You know, it moves really fast. The intention of this game, one, is for it to be very easy to pick up and learn. So while I love Yu-Gi-Oh! And Magic and some of these other games, you know, I was actually just looking yesterday. There's a Yu-Gi-Oh! Card with 99 words on it, like 99 English words. 538 characters, which is, that's just how the game is. And if you're a Yu-Gi-Oh player, you're kind of used to it. You're not like, right? But for non-Yu-Gi-Oh players or for non-trading card game players, that can be very overwhelming. That can be a huge burden in itself, right? And so our approach for this game is, let's make the abilities as easy to understand and easily digestible as we possibly can, to the point where, like, you know, you don't have an ability that's longer than 3 lines, right? And so, and the abilities themselves should feel self-explanatory to allow for that fast pace. So when we were playing this game in person last month, we had people that have never played trading card games before, people that have played trading card games before, but they've never played this before. They would learn it within like 5 to 10 minutes, you know, 20 minutes later, they're teaching newer players how to play the game, like just seeing that, right? So just the ease of picking up, we wanted it to be fast because we wanted it to feel like a fighting game, as less of a, you know, oh, I got to sit down and think 12 moves ahead, and more like, okay, boom, 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 boom. Okay, I did this, boom, and then it's done. You want to play again, right? And have that fighting game kind of feel. And then thirdly, just the flavor of these cards, right? You have abilities in this game that sound very much like hip hop, like re-up or invest, trap cards, because we have trap music, you know what I mean, in hip hop. There's abilities called fly, which is, you know, where artists don't have to battle, they can just fly directly into the opponent, which, you know, from a trading card game perspective, these are kind of familiar keywords, but in the hip hop context, it just gives it that extra sense of like, oh, this is a hip hop trading card game, just as much as it is a card game and just as much as it is hip hop. So all of those were very intentional decisions. So you can both feel like you're in a completely new hip hop world while also feeling like the strategy matters with the cards, depending on how you play them and things like that. I'll stop nerding out, but that's the gist.
For you, this is an adult game, right?
It's like 13 and up.
Yeah, 30. Okay, got it. But what's the core audience age group that you are targeting, that they are the ones who are going to use and play this a lot?
Between high school and college kids. Although we've seen adult kids really, really want to play as well. So, but that our core is in that, like, you know, mid, late teens, early 20s kind of space.
Got it. And given this is an idea, right, how have you researched? Have you researched it at this point already that in the online avatar also it will work? Or do you think these games are generally, you know, works only in the card format?
That's an interesting question. So I did not look into whether or not this game could exist in like other formats, mostly just because once I was getting the feedback on it being in this format, it was like, okay, let's move here. I will say though, just to pull back a little bit, in the gaming industry, there's already examples of hip hop artists, like celebrity hip hop artists, although, you know, you'll have some like hip hop inspired characters in other games, typically in like fighting games or shooting games. And so the concept of putting hip hop in games isn't a novel idea in itself. And people coming up with the idea of let's make hip hop trading cards is not novel either. There have been different examples of like Upper Deck or Topps or whatever, making, you know, a Lil Wayne card. I said Lil Wayne, a Lil Wayne card, that like is just a card, right? It's like a collectible card, but it's not a game, right? And so as far as there being a hip hop trading card game, especially in the way that we're making it, that just has not existed. I'm not gonna say people haven't tried to do it. I just haven't seen it exist, right? And everybody that I'm speaking to that are hearing about Five Mics, they're also like, we haven't heard it exist. So I don't wanna say that we're the first, but we are pushing ourselves to make this exist, right? And so from that standpoint, I've been thinking of Five Mics as the gateway to a completely new universe, right? Yeah. Like our goal is to be the Pokemon of hip hop, the Marvel universe of hip hop. We're starting with a trading card game, but because our characters are unique IP, you know, we're making our own versions of Pikachus and Spider-Mans and things of that nature. Our goal is to branch out even outside of just the trading card game and venture into, you know, other avenues, whether it is like we have a fighting game version of our characters, right? Or a RPG, or a, you know, name the different gaming genre, or, you know, moving into this platform or that platform, right? So as far as like what the future holds for Five Mics, I mean, it can be as vast as, you know, we can dream and afford, right? But the crux of the idea for me was less about whether or not this is the specific subgenre of gaming we should build in. It was more so just the fact that there's a gap in this particular spot in gaming that does not exist and people want, and I want it too. So the combination of those three things, right? Because if I didn't want it, trust me, Abhinay, I would still be working at YouTube, or like, you know what I mean? Like, why would I be doing this, right? When I have like a whole family and life and, you know, things to do, right? But like, I want this, people want this, it's not there. I don't feel like I'm copying anybody, to be honest with you, right? When some people are like, oh, well, you know, compare yourselves to like this company or that company. It's like, well, I can, but it's hard because, you know, they're not building in this space, right? And this space, by the way, like some people can look at it as a niche, but you and I both know that hip hop is big in India. It's big in Norway. It's big in Nigeria. It's big in Japan. So we can act like it's a niche, but Meg Thee Stallion has a big TikTok, you know, streaming, trending dance right now that's inspired by anime and she's doing music with J-pop artists, K-pop art, right? Like it's hard to say that hip hop is a niche and it's hard to say that gaming is a niche. And I don't know, man, I'm just excited about what the future holds. I think it's the fact that people haven't been building in it that, you know, no one really knows the potential of this, you know? So yeah. Anyway, that's why I'm doing it. It's like, it's not there. I want to make it. People want it. Let's make it happen.
The next part, which is there, now that, you know, you have a fair idea of, you know, what you want to do. You have taken some time. You have been part of Techstars. You have got some recognition. I'm assuming you got some funds there, seed funds in a way, or pre-seed fund to start building, right?
Tiny bit. It felt more like a family and friends, but yeah.
but that's there, right? Yeah. Do you think that, now this is a question, right? I am being a little direct here. Do you think you are taking a lot more time to launch or are you happy with the progress you are making and can wait a little longer for the app to come out and the real feedback to come to you?
Yeah. No, I listen, if it was up to me, I would have been dropped and released and done all the things. But the realities of coding and some of the different struggles on that front has definitely made the timeline go longer. Right now, for example, we were just about to get this ready to release on iOS for test flight, but there was something in the game. The database that we were using inside the game was incompatible for iOS, so we had to spend the next 3 to 4 days over Labor Day weekend to swap databases so that we can have it actually be iOS compatible. But then we did that, and now a new issue has arisen with iOS, right? So it's that like, you know, delay. But that being said, case in point, we were at DreamCon end of July. We were playing the physical version of this game with real people. And people were saying like, hey, if you had this available for purchase, we would buy some right now. And so knowing that we already have the physical cards able to be played, we also designed some starter deck boxes for, you know, stack, you know, pack these physical decks in. And we're going to soon launch a pre-order campaign for the physical version of this game. So the kind of going back to what we were saying earlier, you know, it's not, people really want this, and it's not enough to try to strive for perfect. I literally just want good. I literally just want iOS to be like, yo, this is good enough. Like, it's okay. But iOS is like, no, we needed to be perfect. So we're like fighting with iOS to like be more perfect just so that we can be good. But simultaneously, we're not even letting that stop us, right? So we're doing whatever we can to get some version of this game out to the people that we know are wanting it, right? That are in our Discord, that are in our Instagram, that are in our email list, just, you know, hounding us kind of, you know, where is it? I want it right now. And so all that to say, I don't want to blame the code, but the code is a part of the problem. But as we're working on the solution, we're also working on other solutions in order to make this game come out ASAP. While also, you know, doing some teasing online and in our Discord. Hey, here's what we got. Here's what we're looking at. You know, can't just disappear forever.
Got it. So actually, that makes sense as well, right? You're working on the online part. It's a new world, so I can understand that it's taking time. But at the same time, you mentioned, right, whatever you could do, you could try something. You are doing it. So maybe you'll have the off card version that people can directly play come out soon as well.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay. So that makes sense as well. And also, I think this is one of the things take time, right? But I am happy to hear at least, right, from you. It's not about just that you want to make it perfect. It's also about the part that, you know, there are a few things that have to be done when you are building for iOS and so on. So that makes sense as well. My next question is, so it will take some time. That's fine. If I have to ask you today at this point, what will make Ace really happy, right? What do you think is, in your head, a good number? How many players or, you know, what's the target you have in case it achieves? You'll feel really happy in 1 year. This many people are playing, you know, on 5 mics or doing something. What would that number be?
Man, I might make some investors upset, but there's not really a number that would make me happy. It could be one person. In fact, there's a person right now in Japan at an anime Japan expo. I don't know exactly what it is, but posted on an Instagram post, not an Instagram story where it disappears in 24 hours, on their Instagram like feed, a picture of their hand holding a five mic sticker in front of the Japan expo, being like, five mics, we made it. Like, what? Like, this, they're not even playing the game. The game's not out. We just talked about the game having issues, so the game's not even out. They're holding a sticker. I guess the sticker still has the white part on the back, so the sticker's not stuck on anything. He's just holding the sticker in Japan, saying, look, five mics, we're here. And this is just a person who came across five mics in person, had an engagement with us, and loves what we're doing so much that they're holding on to the sticker and traveling abroad with it. Like, Abhinay, it could be a million fake bots, which people do, right? Like, people fake these numbers. I've seen it in music. I'm seeing it in gaming. Like, if we can't love vanity metrics more than we love the people that care about our product. And if I can build real people that love our thing, one human being at a time, one life at a time, if they're literally out there just telling people about five mics that doesn't even exist yet, imagine when it exists. So I can't give you a number. I can just tell you that there are real people that love this and I care about them. And it'll just work the way it needs to work. I truly believe it.
Wow. That's a fantastic answer, by the way, right? One super lover of five mics. That's what you are looking at this point, and how it goes is from there, right?
I've hit the Billboard chart. I've had millions of streams on projects and songs, and you know, my music has been in commercials and all these different things. But what's always impacted me more is when a person will come out and know. I remember it was like 2020, 2019, 2020. Somebody came, hit me up on Instagram and was like, yo, I live in Norway. I've been a fan of yours for 2 or 3 years. I can't wait for your next album. Your music has inspired me to be a paratrooper. And I was like, you've been a fan of mine for 3 years. At 3 years ago, I was like, I don't know if I'm even doing something worth it, right? The music that I was making at the time, when I look back in hindsight, I'm like, oh, that's not even my best work, da 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 da. This person secretly, right? Because while I'm in my own head being like, what am I doing with my life? This person abroad for 3 years has been loving everything that I've been putting out and then just decides to let me know when I'm like, right? Like, oh, hey, I've been following you since this, da 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 da, keep it going, X, Y, and Z. And your music is changing my life. If I'm impacting one person, it doesn't matter all the other stuff. Because again, this stuff can be fake. But if it's real people, then that's what it's for. I'm here to serve people. I'm actually here to be a light and inspire and help people move forward. And if me building five mics, not like, yes, I want you to play the game. I want you to experience all of the crazy thoughts that we're having and all the cool conversations that me and the community are having about like the lore and stuff like that, right? But even if you just decide to say that you're not a gamer, you don't want to care, da da da. But if you just even see how I'm moving, if you see what I'm building, if you see how I'm living my life and that inspires you to do something in your life, then I'm still doing my job. Like, I can't quantify that. I can't quantify that, you know?
That's beautiful. That's beautiful, Ace. So it's inspiring to hear, right? Basically, as long as, by the way, I'm getting inspired as well, right? When I hear your
thoughts. I'm happy to hear.
Yeah. I got a couple of, in fact, one of the questions that which I have also written was around this, you know, that I thought I'll ask you. But you have already answered that one, that, you know, in terms of launch, how you see this one. But at this point, do you see that 1.5 years is what you have spent building five mics so far, right? Do you think you have made some mistakes? Which one really hurts sometimes, right? Hey, I wasted so much time, effort, energy, whatever it is, right? And you say, if my brother is building something, I would probably, say, don't do this. Is there an advice there?
Yeah. So many. But Do you want the biggest one or do you just want one of them? I'm going through the list.
Which one do you think you think makes a lot of sense? Just share that. That should be good.
I would say bringing on somebody on your team without doing the proper due diligence can be a very big mistake. You know, just bringing on somebody because they're a friend, bringing on somebody because you're not comfortable saying no, you're not a fit, bringing on somebody because you're just ignorant to what you need done, right? Like if I'm just like, hey, I need a thing, Abhinay's like, hey, I can do the thing. You're like, hey, cool, come on board. And it's like, you didn't even attempt to check if Abhinay could actually do the thing. Abhinay might just actually be here for money and can't do the thing. People lie. People use ChatGPT to construct their answers. People, you know, read enough about you and say things about you to make you think that they know about the job, but really they just know about you and they're stroking your ego. So now you think that they're capable of doing something that they can't do. Like, right? Doing the proper like hiring sequence, asking them the real questions, asking them like, who do you want to be when you grow up? Like, what are your real career goals? What are you trying to do? Because if, right, like just, and then giving them like, you know, I was, when I had to apply to be a consultant at Deloitte, like I had to do like cases, you know what I mean? I had to be like, hey, this soda company is losing money over here in Spain, but they're based in Germany. Like, and I had to like, oh, okay, well, it might be this. It might like put them to work before they work, like understand if they can even do the thing, but then also, right, like understand their motives. Are you here because this is actually something that you want to do? Are you just here because you need money? Which, by the way, is not a bad reason, but when you're a small startup where every human being on your team matters, you need people that are just as committed and crazy as you are. And if you are just posted up to get a paycheck and you don't even care and you can't even do the work, or you do the work but it's not up to your standards, but you don't even know what your own standards are because you're not even like you have to do the work to understand your standards and then put them to that standard to see if they match it. If you're not doing that, oh, are you in for a horrible surprise? And I've been through that. So I'm getting viscerally upset, but yeah.
No, that makes, that's what exactly, right? But people hiring, firing, in early stage, it's so important that if you do not, sometimes, right, the whole execution part of hiring and getting the right team in place and the right people is so, so important. So thanks for sharing that. Similar advice has been given by many others. Now I'm going to just change the track a little bit and come to hip hop, right? I know nothing about hip hop. The last time to me, the hip hop thing came through Gully Boy, right?
You hey, so you do know about hip hop. Don't lie.
yeah, so that's there. So tell me one thing, any idea how many people across the globe follow hip hop? Any data, anything that you have around hip hop? Is there something that you know that you can share?
Yeah. The only one that I have that I guess is of some importance is that $2 billion are made in hip hop global streaming. But that's just the streaming revenue. That's not including, concerts, merch, you know, pop-up events, Snoop Dogg being the Olympic host and making $16 million, right? Like that, none of those additional revenue pieces are factored into this $2 billion. This is just off of passive hip hop streaming like that across the globe, $2 billion the last time I checked. So, I mean, it's pretty sizable.
And that actually, because you have been associated with music for so long, you have been part of YouTube. Do you see with this growth around music, hip hop, culture, there is a lot of scope just for startups or businesses focused, and I'm talking about online businesses, technology businesses, not the concerts, etc., right? That will definitely grow with as artists grow. Just focus, like yours is a startup around hip hop. Do you see good number of startups coming with innovative ideas. And if you have to pick, let's say, a couple of ideas that, hey, this could have been done. Do you see that happening around music?
Yeah. So it's pretty cool. Like, there's this one company, for example, shout outs to Magic Rodriguez. He created this company called Even. And what Even does is allows for you as a fan to pay whatever you want, $1, $50, $1,000, whatever you want, to listen to my album before it drops, get exclusive access and ownership to it, as well as any other additional like add-ons that I add to that package before I release it on streaming. It gives you, and a bunch of other things like baked into that, but at high level, right? You're paying for access to music that you can listen to and stream on your own time, but earlier than kind of like everyone else, right? The casual fans. What that allows is a few things. One, it gives you a closer and deeper relationship with that artist that you really love, because you're only going to do something like that if you actually love that artist. Two, it allows for that artist and their team to make a significant amount more in revenue from selling things like that than just relying on traditional streaming, which pays you about 0.005 cents per stream. And that's just the world that we live in now, right? So it doesn't replace it, but it adds on top of that, right? Because then eventually you drop it on streaming and then you do the thing, you do the tours, all that stuff. So for the artists, it gives them like an additional and a significantly more amount of revenue on not that many people, right? So like if you need 10,000 people to make a certain amount of dollars, like you can have 100 people give you $1,000 each, right? And you can make significantly more just using it. And then the third thing, it's really changing the way that people value music. Ever since, you know, the Napsters and the LimeWires of the world, there's just been this assumption that music should be free, right? That you shouldn't pay for it at all. And yeah, Apple came in and then kind of reset the standard, like, no, 99 cents. Music is at least worth that, right? And now we have this new standard that's like, music is worth 0.005 cents. And so, you know, Even has really allowed for this shifting of mindset of like, no, music isn't worthless. Music is invaluable. Music is whatever you say it's worth. And I will give you the opportunity to say how much music is worth. And you will do so by looking at the artist that you really love, that you appreciate, that, oh, if I don't do this, like, you know, they're probably not going to make more music. And I love when they make music. So I want to be a part of this and I want to help push them forward. It actually gives more power to the fans to be like, hey, let me say that this person's music is valuable and I'm going to put some dollars behind it. So I think the combination of those three things, I think that Mag and his team have done a really great job in changing the landscape of music from that front. And, you know, there's tons of others. But yeah, music has issues, man. So tons of ways to create some solutions out of there.
Oh, super, super to hear that. In fact, you know, that there can be, it has evolved over time. There are now solutions and it will have its own creative ideas. Thanks for sharing this example as well. I hope as we end this podcast, I'm so happy to, you know, have this conversation. Really insightful. Love the entire discussion we have had, you know, from where you started, from where you are. I hope next time we speak, right, and we speak our podcast, right, you and 5Max has grown and people are giving example that, hey, 5Max has done this for the hip-hop industry, for the gaming industry. They have done that. This is how they have innovated. And there's lots and lots of customer love. With CleverTap, we are really excited that you're part of the Retention Accelerator. We get to work together and we are really, really cheering for you and your teams.
Thank you.
Exponential growth happening soon, but yeah, a lots of customer love.
Thank you so much, Abhinay. It really means a lot. Thank you and the team for selecting us to be a part of the accelerator. The love's been real. The resources have been real, and just really excited to see what the future holds. Yeah, I absolutely receive the blessing and can't wait to keep you posted on how we evolve.
Thank you so much for your time, Ace. We'll be in touch. Thank you. Take care.
Awesome. Thank you. Have a blessed one. Cheers.